I was telling you not that long ago about DMT, right? We're talking about DMT for like a little bit in the movie theater. Remember I was telling you about like this, like, it's like, okay. So I'm just going to tell you what DMT is real quick, right? To get into like a better conversation. So DMT is produced in the human, in humans, right? Like as we know so far, right? So DMT, they say it's produced in the liver, I believe in the kidneys, and then the pineal gland, right? Which is like your third eye type shit, right? What's interesting about like this whole research with DMT is that it is considered a Schedule One drug, so it is like illegal, as you know, it's like a hallucinogen type of thing. Mm-hmm. You know, in science, the way they explain things is very different than how you explain it when it comes from a spiritual standpoint, mm-hmm. or like an experience standpoint. You get me?
Oh, this was that we're watching that movie, right? That the comedy.
Yeah, what was it? I forgot what movie you want to go watch.
The one where the Like a Boss, I think it was, right?
Yeah, Like a Boss. There you go. I'll tell you a little bit about that. So essentially, so you produce DMT naturally, like in your body. They say that the only time you experience like, or like big amounts of DMT, and again, I'm not a factual on all of this, so you know, you could check me, when you're first born and when you die. Right, like when people are about to die, it's like, oh, I saw this white light, mm-hmm. and I saw this, and I saw that. Yeah. I mean, like you see different things. So the basis of science is like that you are experiencing some type of DMT, right? Which is like, I forgot, DMT is like an acronym for like the actual long ass name, mm-hmm. which is fucking long as hell. So what I want to get to is like, you know, people that experience DMT, first of all, it doesn't last very long. You get me? Depending on how you take it. It's all natural for one. So one way is ayahuasca. So they have ayahuasca ceremonies like in like Costa Rica, where it's like literally leaves and roots. Like they mix them together and you drink it. And that trip can last for about 8 hours. You get me? So that was really long. And then there's one that's like, for example, like they call it the toad, right? So like in the South Amazon, like rainforest. Well,
they lick the... The toad?
It kind of like, well, you don't really lick it, but you kind of have the, yeah. the sense. That it's like this toad that its glands, yeah. secretes like this venom. Yeah, it's the venom. So what they do is that they rub it like on glass and they let it dry out. What they do is scrape it out so it'll be like crystallized and you smoke that, right? And that trip lasts for about 15 minutes. So from people's experiences, you begin to see shapes and, you know, different types of like geometric things, and people describe it weird because there's everyone who tries to describe what they experience. Mm-hmm. Their words cannot describe what they have experienced. Yeah, yeah. It's almost like a spiritual thing. You know what I mean? Like, you know, when you go to an encounter, you experience something, is words cannot describe certain things that you went through. You get what I'm saying? Course. So those are the kind of connections I'm starting to make with some of these things. I'm like, damn, okay. I'm reading up, listening to things. So to get to one of the experiences that was probably the most like clean cut video, and I'll show you in a little bit so you can kind of get a gist of it. The guy who went through this stuff, he was an atheist, but he said like after that experience he can no longer be an atheist. Like he believes that there is something, because essentially what this takes you in is almost like you are no longer there. This is what everybody says, like your ego dies for one, you get me? And the things that you experience in this trip is like, yo, you just go into like this weird, like you see things and you experience things and you go down, like it's like, yo, it's like in your head, right? Like you may close your eyes and like if you see a hallway, be like, yo, go down the hallway. You know what I mean? If you see like somebody talking to you, talk to that person. It's like, it's almost like, you know, you're having these interactions, right? So it's crazy. Like from a science standpoint, from us just hearing it, you're like, all right, that sounds kind of crazy. I don't want to experience that, whatever, right? We kind of write it off. What I kind of want to get to though is like, yo, we write off so much things in life, right? When we don't understand, mm-hmm. we're like, nah, yeah. I'm good on that. Nah, that's weird. That's trippy. Whatever, whatever, whatever. What if some of these things that we deem to be bad or negative or whatever brings you closer to what maybe you are supposed to be at? So, you know, you're a Christian, right? I would subscribe to the exact same thing as far as like what I believe in. Other people believe in different things, whatever that energy, whatever, yeah. whatever the fuck it
yeah,
is.
Yeah, yeah.
But like, what I want to get to is this. If somebody, let's say something smart, right? Like if somebody could say, yo, I smoked weed and this brings me closer to God. Who are you to say that that's wrong? Mm. Or like, what is your thought process in general? And yeah. the reason I said that, just to kind of save you this, I don't know if you heard, but there is like this, this like Christianity and weed thing come out. You heard about that, right? Like the people that they'll get high
and try to have like a closer encounter with Jesus.
Yeah, like they have like groups and shit like that, right? Like, there's like this woman who has a whole group, like a whole I guess like they literally will get high and then they'll, it's like cell, like having cell. Then you start talking about. So I kind of want to hear your thoughts, you know, about this real quick.
I mean, I've heard that, but obviously I haven't heard details of how that plays out. For me personally, remember, because sometimes what we do is we'll hear somebody's take and we'll assume that that's everybody in the faith's take, right? And that's not fair to people.
Yeah.
This is my take from my background, my upbringing, my faith understanding. I just try to stay away from things that try to complicate the gospel.
Okay.
Right? You know, for example, for me, it's all about Jesus died for my sins, right? And I have sins because I've done things that don't please God. That's how I define sin. And then he rose again in victory, right? And in that victory, I have a new life. As if I believe that he died and that he rose. If anything I do can take away from that or distract from that, I try to stay away from that. For example, like if I need weed or if I need psychedelic drugs or whatever, or hallucinogens, to have a spiritual opening of that, then I don't think the Bible is true. And if I don't think the Bible is true, then for that I should just stop being a Christian. Because the Bible says that I believe because it's the Holy Spirit that works within me. Right? And so there is this level of I don't fully understand who the Holy Spirit is, because none of us will. We just understand what the Bible describes him to be, which is a counselor, which is a guide, is a helper, is a friend.
Yeah.
Right? But the Bible does recognize that we are spiritually blind in some aspects. Like, we don't fully understand until God gives us vision and clarity. And I think that comes through the Holy Spirit. But as man, we always try to find other routes. And that's where I think the danger is.
And I don't want to cut you off, because I know you're going. But so I don't forget. So the thing with this, though, and to cancel out the weed, because that's more, you know, I guess recreational in some aspects. But to focus on the DMT, though, the DMT is not like a... It's not something that you do like on a daily basis.
No, it's like a one-time practice. Exactly. I'm assuming,
So, like, what I'm saying is, like, some people that have been on this thing experience something that, like, is overwhelmingly eye-opening in a sense. Mm-hmm. You get me? And it brings out this, like, to some people, like, you know, it brings out almost like, for example, like some people that just don't believe in nothing come out and they believe in something now, and they might not know what that something is yet. But
it opens the door, at least.
Right. Yeah. Like to be like, okay, like there is something more than just this. Mm-hmm. Like, we don't just die and that's it. Yeah, man. We're not, you know, it's more to this. You get me? Yeah. So that thing, because you said, you know, if you need to get high, you need to get this just to believe in it. I can understand why that would be fucked up. But like, you know, in some cases, like, yo, you do this once, you now have like this thing and you might go on a journey now to like something else. You get me? Like,
and I think to make it clear.
Yeah.
God is bigger than me.
Yeah.
Right? I firmly believe that God can do and reach people through any medium. That might throw somebody off. I think it ultimately leads you back to Jesus.
Yeah.
That Jesus is the only way, the truth, the life, you know, and the truth. No one gets to the Father except through him. Yeah. That's firmly where I stand. But I do think that God can reach people even in ways that we as Christians sometimes are not fully capable of accepting.
Yeah.
Like, I'll give you the perfect example is the apostle Saul, Paul, right? Mm-hmm. Paul's on his way to murdering people.
Yeah.
Like, that's what he's going to do. Right? Yeah, but he's on his way to murdering people in Damascus.
Yeah.
And that's where Jesus meets him.
Yeah.
You know, that might throw off your theology, because a lot of us is like, oh, God's going to meet you when you're in the right place at the right time. This guy was literally, like, if God doesn't meet him there, he's about to go kill some people right now.
Yeah.
You know, and
more specifically Christian people.
That was his thing, right? So he's going to go kill Christians, right? Mm-hmm. Right now. Yeah. And God, in that moment, interrupts him, changes his life forever.
Yeah.
Right? And that's something to be said about that. Moses, in the other story, Moses, Old Testament, is running away from God because he murdered somebody.
Yeah.
He's hiding, right? So people don't kill him.
Yeah.
And God calls him out where he's hidden. Mm. I think that we need to break this idea that we understand God, because we don't.
Yeah.
You know, even the Bible says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no, the thoughts, the plans that he has for you.
Yeah.
Right? Like, there's nothing that you and I could conceive, if we think God is really that great, that could limit God from being who he is. Yeah. God is a God who saves people, and he could do it through that experience. Mm-hmm. I just think that it wouldn't be ideal. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah,
but I firmly believe that God can even use that experience.
Is that my thing is this. So if we could, you know, again, like, as researchers, I guess as human knowledge and evolution has gone, we do not use 100% of our
brain.
And you know, we are, to be said, created in God's image, this and that. So when just my thought, right, and I'm gonna throw this out there, you tell me. So do you think if we could use 100% of our brain, would we be God-like?
Yeah, I think.
Will we be able to create stuff and like
well,
like
create
cells and, you know, like atoms, like manipulate them and.
Yeah, I think that there's certain principles, certain laws that got established, and we still will fall within those because he has a sovereignty or, so it's not the whole idea of like, oh, the creation becomes greater than the creator. I think that can happen.
Right.
The moment that's possible, then God stops being God. Right.
Right. Right.
I do think that there is a limitation to a lot of things. Like, for example, I don't think it's far-fetched that we could have a certain unlocking to the point that we can speak to animals.
Okay.
Or the animals could speak to us, you know.
Yeah.
Because it's the whole idea that a serpent spoke to man.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, I mean, Adam and Eve allegedly could speak to animals.
And so the serpent spoke to man, right?
Yeah.
But then eventually, and he used to walk, apparently, according to the Garden of Eden, the story of Genesis.
Yeah, had legs.
So it could walk. So there is this, because of sin, at least in the biblical
sense,
we regressed.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that all of humanity for years, what we've been trying to do is get back to that place. Because we all kind of yearn like this of this idea that we should be able to do more, be more, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like transcend this humanity, this brokenness.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that is biblical. You know, mm-hmm. Ecclesiastes says, God has put eternity in your heart. And there's a part of you that says, yo, there's something more for me. It can't just be here. And so that's the whole idea why so many faiths and so many spiritual journeys exist, because we all... I think most of us, not all of us, but most of us say there has to be more.
Mm-hmm.
It can't just be I live 80 years and I die and this is the end of this.
Yeah.
Like, there has to be more. Mm-hmm. And I think that is the beauty of Christianity, is that it points us not to a thing that is more, but to a person that has more for us.
Mm.
That is where I think differs from a lot of other beliefs.
Yeah. I mean, it's an interesting take, though, because, you know, me personally, like, and just like you said, God can come to you in many ways.
Yeah,
you
know what I mean? Yeah, I don't want to limit that ever.
The thing is, like, even like with religion in general, right? Like, religion is war amongst religions, this and that, the third. The thing is that at the end of the day, it's all about the same thing. It's all about God. It all comes down to God, whatever your God is, but it all comes down to God regardless. You know what I mean? Like, hands down, right? So there's many wars, you know, again, I'm not like, I don't know a whole shit a ton about every religion, you know what I mean? But essentially, like, some of these things that, like, I hear and stuff, like, you know, we just deem as, like, oh, no, this is bad. Like, you know, we talked about, look, alcohol. No, that. Like, yo, you should not drink alcohol.
Like a closed-mindedness.
Exactly. Like, you know, when I think about certain things, like, yo, I say that to just say, like, I think that, you know, we need to reach at this stage in life. It's not about being, I don't want to say open-minded, as in, like, oh, you need to try these things. I'm saying we need to understand these things.
The dialogue of it,
like,
at least.
Mm-hmm. Like, for example, the minute you hear, so, for example, like, I feel personally like we're just, as humans, we're just programmed. Like, at this point, like, the more you hear and the more you think, it's just, it's so, like, think about this, bro. It's easier for you to go to college, get a degree, get an office job, 9 to 5, get paid X amount, have a 401k, all that stuff. When I start hearing about it and it starts to click, it's easy because it's just, we're programmed.
It's what you've been hearing, seeing, believing, preaching to each other.
It's what you've been doing your whole life. Yeah. For the moment you're in school, right, you answer to a superior, right, who tells you.
Yeah, you've been passing it on. It's like a factory. We just created.
Exactly. Look, you start in school, right? And for that, like, Fatima, the teacher, right? So she schedules her entire kid's day. This is the time you're going to eat. I don't know how it works, but whatever. This is the time you're going to eat. This is the time you're going to have recess. This is the time you're going to read. This is the time you're going to do this. You're going to do that. You're going to do that. As we grow, we're doing that to school the entire time,
right?
You get to college. Okay. Now you kind of start figuring yourself out a little bit more.
And that's why we always have that. Yeah, we always have that clash where it's like, yo, there was nobody who cared or told me what to do.
Exactly.
People fail because of that.
Exactly. Because, like, first of all, the first thing I saw when I went to college is, I'll never forget this. A kid raised and said, excuse me, mister, can I go to the bathroom?
I don't care.
The first thing he said was, yo, I don't care. Like, you do whatever you want. You're a grown up. And everybody was like.
Yeah, it's like anarchy.
Yeah, it's like everybody was like, okay. Like, because it's weird. Yeah. Like, we're so used to like, oh, can I go to the bathroom? No. Okay. When you roam the halls, you got to have a hall pass. When you get me, like, everything is. So now when you get. So, man, you've been doing this for years. I'm talking about, like, bro, you've been doing this for, like, 12 years. You get me? Mm-hmm. So you get out of school. And most people, like, yo, what you've learned in school and stuff like that, depending on your, you know, your personality or whatever, it's just easier for you to, yo, I got to go to, 9 to 5 is, yo, I got to be here at this time. I got to do this. Yeah, yeah. I go to lunch at this time.
Order.
Exactly. Order. And that's it. And you, because you've been accustomed to doing that your whole life. You know what I mean? So it's just easier for you to, so that's just one version of what I say by we're programmed. You know what I mean? I truly believe we're programmed. And by saying that, is that anything that seems weird to us, and that we're not knowledgeable of, we automatically cut off.
Bad.
We're like, nah, that shit is
bad.
Weird. Yeah, that's shit. For example, so a lot of people have, especially, so we'll talk about like older Hispanics, right? Their view on tattoos is, oh, you're a thug, you're a gangster. Because for them growing up was, whoever had tattoos was the gang members and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You're going through your entire life thinking that. So you are programmed now. Like, you look, every time you look, you see somebody with tattoos, you're programmed to automatically associate that with, oh, that's bad. Mm-hmm. That's danger. That's a gangster. That's this and that. Now you come into the station, you put that person into a different environment. There's a bunch of people with tattoos for
it's
different
a cultural
reasons.
Clash.
And it has zero to do with any gang, any violence, anything of criminal order, anything. You know what I mean? It's just like, you could be a librarian who's like super sweet, has a quadrillion kittens, a nice marriage, has a book club, and has a freaking tattoo of, I don't know, a freaking book in her hand. You get me? And when you see that, you automatically associate that with something bad. It's not that you can, oh, that's a gangster. But you see a tattoo, it's like, associate with something. That's programming. You get me?
No, for sure.
So
I think the best example is drugs.
Yeah.
We automatically, especially when, like, you know, the older generations, automatically associated, and I mean Hispanic, associated any kind of drug with, like, delinquents.
Yeah.
Right? But you see, like, hippies were smoking, you know, way back in the days. Or nowadays, like, I remember I used to do deliveries back in the days when I was working at Delhi.
Yeah.
And there was this one time that this lawyer, like, super rich lawyer, was like, yo, you sure you don't want to smoke with me?
Yeah.
And I was like, and they shook me that morning because I was like, this is not how my parents taught me drugs work. Like,
that
the successful lawyer should not be smoking weed. Like, what?
Yeah.
Right? But it's because of that. We get this program, this kind of normative education that is just like, this is how things are. You know, this is square, this is rectangle, this is triangle. Yeah. Nobody question it.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah. So in this is what I'm trying to get at. Like, in that bubble, you know, like, I feel like what society has created is a bubble, right? A box. And everyone is building within this box. But I feel like the reality, bro, is that, like, and just like you said, man, like, God puts that eternity in your heart and you feel like you're meant for more because there is more. I feel like there is more. You get me? Like, like, society has put this box, right, of safety. It's like, for the masses, this works. So everybody's like, all right, you know what? This works, so let me follow this. And there's very few people that decide to come out of the box. You get me? And there's those people that come out of the box and succeed.
Yeah, the visionaries.
That we look at as, oh, the Albert Einsteins, the Kobe's, the whatever. You get me? Like we deem these people as like, oh my, so superior. But the thing is that, like, so many people have the potential to do what all of these people have done in different branches, not in the same thing. Mm-hmm. Not everybody's the Albert Einstein. Not everybody's the Kobe. Not everybody's a super athlete, a super genius. There's people that are good at different things. You know what I mean? There's people that are, bro, look, man, we live in a time where now kids who review toys make $28 million a year. You get what I'm saying? Like, let's just put that into perspective for 1 minute. You get me? How, like, there's different things that you can do in this life, period. You get what I'm saying? Like, you don't have to be put in the box. 10 years ago, 20 years ago, if you would tell your parents, oh, I'm gonna do you. Look, nowadays, you tell your parents, I want to be a YouTuber, they might be more lenient. Be like, all right, you know, go ahead, do your thing. You know what I mean? Try the YouTube thing, see how that works out. 10, 20 years ago, bro, like, yo, you're not gonna make no money. What the fuck are you doing? Go to school.
Literally, yesterday, we were in a church thing, and I was listening to some kids talk about what they wanted to do when they grew up. One kid said, I just wanna record me playing video games. Yeah. And I was like, yo, that's not. That wasn't a profession 5 years ago.
Nope.
But now it's a legit profession.
Yeah.
And I was like, dang, life has changed.
Yeah. But you see, that's out of the box things right now. You know what I mean? Like, look, Lil Duval has said something. He said, imagine years from now, right? Things that are deemed, like, unacceptable right now, 10 years from now are going to be deemed normal. He said that's exactly how people from the 90s are looking at y'all. Because people in the 90s, the shit that y'all doing right now, in the 90s, that shit was not acceptable. Yeah. That shit was not, but now it's like, yo, it's a norm. Mm-hmm. You get me? And as we evolve as humans, this happens. You get me? But, like, I feel like the people who break through are the people who question shit. The people who, like, I don't know if I want to do this. Let me try something else. Let me do this. Let me do that. Because, like, once you're aware that, like, yo, you're right. I'm in a cycle. I'm in a program. I'm in the matrix, whatever. once you're aware of that, it is there your responsibility, I feel, to unplug yourself from whatever machine. You know
what I mean? But there's also like that, and you talked about the whole idea of you have somebody telling you what to do. There's also the status quo that something doesn't let you, because the moment you start speaking against what is considered normal, no, you're not. Right? There's this this idea that the moment you become, you know, outspoken against the system, against whatever, you become a threat to the system and you get eliminated, right? You know, think about MLK, think about Malcolm X, think about, you know, JFK. You mentioned all throughout history, you know, people we have tried to kill or shut down because their ideas seemed too progressive or too radical or too... Yeah. And so there is always that danger of, like, if you stick out, you bring a spotlight to you.
Yeah.
Right? And so most people look like, in that case, it's not
it's
me.
Always,
like, I don't want to be the outsider because that might end up being me.
It's always, though, when you when you are fucking up somebody's money.
Yeah.
Is when that
happens. Yeah. You're challenging the status quo.
I mean, MLK, when he was going to speak, he got killed because he was going to go speak about, like, financial freedom to, like, you know, the less, I guess, progressive, towns or whatever. You know what I mean? Once you start fucking with people's money, that's when shit starts getting serious. You know what I mean? It's always been that forever. You know what I mean? You fuck with the mafia's money, they come into your house, they're gonna come see you, and you and your whole family. You know what I mean? So I understand that point. But I'm just saying, like, at the end, to start, like, I guess little steps here, yo, we need to stop dismissing, like, you know, cancel culture starting to get a little bit dimmed down right now, but it still exists like a motherfucker. And we need to stop, like, dismissing shit without really knowing what it is. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We're quick to be like, okay, well, for example, bro, you might be like, Tylenol, shit, that's normal. Advil, shit, that's normal. Like, yo, those are pills that we just take. Like, you have no clue what's in Advil, what's in Tylenol. You have no clue. And the bottle will tell you, yo, take 15 of these motherfuckers and you will die. You know what I mean? Cat Williams had a joke about that a minute ago. You know what I mean? Like, you would, like, yo, there's certain things that are deemed okay in society. But because they're deemed okay in society, we're like, okay, cool. Yeah. Like, we don't even question
that
shit.
We don't challenge.
Yeah, because everybody else is doing it. That's cool. And I think that's the problem that we're having. Like, too many people are like, yo, fuck it. Like, you never get to experience your true purpose. You never get to live your life because you're worried about the shit that just doesn't fucking matter at the end of the day. You know what I mean? Yo, look, there's people that will buy that nice-ass house, right? And they know, like, yo, if I buy this nice-ass house, I'm going to say goodbye to chilling on Saturdays. I'm going to say goodbye to... vacation. I'm gonna say goodbye to all of that shit because I want this nice house. The question is, why do you want that nice house? Do you want it for the look?
Because if you enjoy
going out on Saturdays and you enjoy vacations, you're gonna sacrifice all of that for what? For you to have a house that eventually is gonna become just dull, just like everything else with humans. But you could get a Lamborghini right now, and I guarantee you, like, in a year or whatever, you're gonna be bored of the Lamborghini.
There's always that next model. There's always that next thing.
That's how humans are. Yeah, man. We get to something, it's just the next thing, the next thing, the next thing, the next thing. So. When it comes, when I'm trying to space this down, like, to when it comes to, like, this spiritual level, I feel like, isn't that what we're meant to do regardless? It's to kind of think outside of the realm. Yeah. Because in society, it's cool to be the nice, cute little Christian. But the minute you become the Christian who's, like, over preachy, over this, over that, now you're like, yo, bro, you're being too much.
You're being too religious, too, blah, blah, blah.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
you're oppressive. Right.
The minute you start becoming too much of something, everybody wants to kind of shut you down. You know what
the perfect example is Jesus.
Right.
Jesus started becoming a problem to the religious status quo. They're like, this has got to go. And they crucified him.
Right.
Right. The only problem is you crucify a martyr. You start awakening a revival. And so now it was a shift of culture. Mm-hmm. And now we're seeing it for 1,000 years, you know, how the death of one man impacted faith, impacted wars, impacted, you know, laws, impacted history in so many multiple ways. Because when, you know, martyrs die, is the beginning of something bigger.
Yeah. That's interesting, man. Well, you know, I don't know. That's all I have to say, man. I kind of wanted to go on some shit I had on my mind lately. And, you know... I think a lot about, like, the future, like, you know, the way that we speak and the way that we think today isn't going to be the way that we think about things later on, because evolution, you know, you evolve, like, your mind evolves. So I just think about, like, these topics right now, like, the way we're talking about them is because they're prevalent right now. Like, they're, you know, they're being, like, some of these things are just getting attention right now. And, like, what's it going to be like in 5 or 10 years from now? How are we going to evolve and articulate these things even more, even better? You know what I'm saying?
What kind of viewpoint are we going to have? What kind of ideals or philosophies? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean...
Because
it's an ever-changing world.
Because my thing is this, like I always say, like, yo, we're recording all of this, all of this stuff. You know, for content, it's best that you break down content for people to be able to digest as best as possible. Mm-hmm. Right? So, like, let's say, like, we take this and we cut these clips out and make them 8-minute clips, 9-minute clips, whatever, you know, so people could adjust. The thing is going to be, like, yo, the evolution of this kind of thought process, what it leads to down the line. Mm-hmm. And I think that that kind of leads, it's not just us. It's, like, thousands of people out there doing the same thing. Yeah. Millions of people, you know what I mean? It leads to... I feel like that's what shows people now, like, okay, we could follow these kind of things, mm-hmm. and we could do X, Y, and Z, or we can listen to X, Y, and Z because it led to this. You get me? Like, when you're kind of new into something and stepping into something, you know, it's hard to show people. You were just talking about it, and, you know, as a person, you got to put into action. But down the line is when you kind of, like, you know, show the results.
Yeah,
like,
you have proof that it worked, whatever it was.
Right, or whatever it was. So, I mean... Yeah, you got anything else to say, man?
No, I think it's pretty good.
Pretty good?
I think you dropped some bars in there.
I think so. You think so?
Yeah.
You drop bars for sure. Especially for the spiritual parts. Cause
so send some offerings. I'm just kidding.
This guy says send offerings. Yeah, man. So, all right, man. Well, once again, man, if you listen to this and you thought that we enlightened you, you thought that we were dumb, you thought that we didn't prepare for this, looking at the phones and stuff. If you're looking at this, you're like, why would I listen to a kid in a do-rag and a guy in some ripped jeans? Like, who wears ripped jeans anymore?
I couldn't afford real pants.
If you're looking at this and you're thinking, why the fuck should I listen to a couple of 24, 25-year-olds who aren't doing shit with their lives? Because maybe that's what you think.
I'm dropping a mixtape.
Yeah, it's okay, man. This is I'm Down, where we talk about whatever, a podcast about nothing.
And everything.
Again, man, we appreciate you if you support us. We appreciate you if you watch this. Leave a like, comment below, interact. I don't say that as just to say it. I really do mean comment, you know, talk some shit, say something, you know what I'm saying? Whatever it may be, man. Till next time.